Dear students, welcome to the class. So, till now we have started chapter number 1, psychological variations and variations in different psychological attributes. We have studied about intelligence in detail. We have discussed how different variations or different attributes are there, like intelligence, aptitude, interest, your personality, your values, and how do we have a different methods of assessment. We studied about formal assessment and informal assessment, and we also studied about formal assessment methods in which we can use projective personality tests, we can use self-report method, we can use interview, observation, we can use case studies. So all these methods we can study about different psychological attributes. We studied about what is intelligence, how different psychologists describe intelligence, and the usage of intelligence in our day-to-day life, and how it helps us to make the decisions. We studied about different theories of intelligence, in which we have studied psychometric approaches, information processing approach. In psychometric approaches, we studied about unifactor theory of intelligence. We also studied about Charles Fairman's two-factor theory, where he is talking about general factor and specific factor. These all we have discussed in previous classes. I'm just doing a recap so that you can form a link between what we have studied and what we are going to study today. The third theory under psychometric which they have included was Louis Thurston's primary mental abilities, which we are talking about different abilities, and then Arthur Jensen's primary level and level 1 and level 2 of intelligence, and then we studied about J.P. Guilford's structure of intellect, where he is talking about content, then the process and the product or the outcome. We studied an information processing approach. Like information processing approach, they focuses on the processes. How do we reach to the conclusion? What all processes are there in the mind when we are reaching to some conclusion or decision making or planning ahead? So in this, Howard Gardner came out with a different multiple intelligences. He says that human beings are not having aggregated general capability or understanding. He says we have multiple intelligence, or we are intelligent in a different ways, and there are multiple ways, and it is not only one or two. We can have a combination of many, and he came out with the 8 different intelligences, and linguistic intelligence, kinesthetically intelligent, we can be spatially intelligent, intrapersonal, interpersonal, and we can have naturalistic intelligence. So there are different 8 varieties of intelligence he has spoken about. And then he also says that all these intelligences we can develop up to an average level. We cannot be bad in music, we cannot be bad in sports or kinesthetic activities. We can be at least an average if we practice and if we do certain activities which can enhance these multiple intelligences. And that is why many of the schools are working on developing these intelligences from the primary level. And this is quite entrained nowadays in schools to apply and modify and enhance on these intelligences of the children. Then we studied about Sternberg's theory of intelligence, where he is talking about contextual intelligence. He is talking about street smart and practical intelligence, analytical intelligence. And then J.P. Guilford, we studied about past model of intelligence, planning, and then attention and simultaneous successive processing. He described based on these 3 processes of information which we process in our mind, or use intelligence to make decisions and to reach out to some conclusion. He developed a test which is cognitive assessment system, CAS, and this test we can use to assess the processing level of the students, which can help us to find out the learning disability of the child. And this test can be utilized from 5 to 18 years of children. On these children we can do the assessment and find out where the child is having the struggle, where he is not able to perform, and how we can help. So this can help us to plan on the remedial sessions for the child, so that he can improve on his academics and studies. After that, we have studied about intelligence and different variations and how IQ has, how IQ is measured and what are different psychological tests, different types of psychological tests. We studied verbal, non-verbal, performance, culture biased, and then we understood about speed tests, power tests, and there are different variations which we have studied and some of the misuses of intelligence tests. So, if there are uses of intelligence tests, there are definitely misuses of the test, and how being a psychology student or psychologist, we should keep these points in mind so that misuses of the psychological test does not happen and does not give a label to a person which can hamper his or her progress or his or her image in the society or in the school system. Now we'll understand how culture and intelligence, how culture shapes up your intelligence. We have already studied the interplay of environment, then the nature and the nurture, the genetics or the hereditary of the human beings in intelligence, and how our environment plays an important role. So it's an interplay. It is not, we cannot say very exactly where the, like how much percentage is of hereditary or the nature or environment plays a role in intelligence. So, because it's a complex phenomena which cannot be described in a very concrete form. So let's understand today in this session, and this will be last class for first chapter, and then it will be over and we'll move on to the second chapter. So in this we will study how your intelligence is affected by the culture in which you are born. You are living in that culture. So when we talk about culture, you already know that there are rituals, there are way of behaving, thinking, doing certain activities in some particular context which you are born in or which you are living in, and that forms a culture. You have already studied about culture in human development chapter number 4 for in 11th class. So culture provides a context, it provides a situation, it provides a environment for intellectual development. If you are having very stimulative environment where your parents, the school keeps on giving some or the other activities, and in a very warm and very congenial environment, definitely your intellectual capacity will flourish, will be better. And suppose if there are a child who is exposed or who is born in that culture where no stimulative activities, no extracurricular activities, no other cognitive activities which can enhance or help the child to enhance their intellectual development. So context plays a very important role which is provided by the culture. So Western culture basically promotes the technological intelligence. So when we talk about technological intelligence, this is basically based on our skills of analysis, performance, speed, achievement, orientation. So technological intelligence basically focuses on the individual's achievement, individual's orientation towards the performance and acquiring the skills. So it is more focused on how do you achieve, what success you are achieving, and what are the speed, how fast you do the things, how do you analyze the things. So analytical skills, achievement orientation is more focused. Whereas in contrast to non-Western culture, or we talk about the Indian culture or like Eastern culture, where we focus more on the self-reflection. If you do certain behavior, how do you reflect on that behavior? How do you understand and evaluate and learn from that experience or that self-reflection? It also talks about social and emotional competence. How do you deal with human beings in your surrounding? How well do you understand your own emotion and others' emotion? That we talk about in Eastern culture or maybe Indian culture, and this is a sign of intelligent behavior. So Indian culture promotes integral intelligence in opposition of technological intelligence. In technological intelligence, we focus on the achievement orientation, analytical skills, and focusing on the acquiring the skills. Whereas integral intelligence, they focus not only these plus social and emotional competence and how a person connects with people and the larger his or her larger social world. So that we talk about in culture and intelligence. So when, in integral intelligence, we talk about four things, which are your cognitive capacity, which means your sensitivity to the context, understanding and discrimination, like how things are different, what do you do in problem solving, use your effective communication. So all these will be in your cognitive capacity. And in social competence, they are talking about respect for social order, commitment to elders and young and needy, and concern about others' welfare and others' well-being. And you recognize others' perspective. So they focus a lot on empathy, developing empathy, so that you understand the others' perspective and you are able to share your own perspective in emotional competence, we will discuss. So emotional competence is basically regulating yourself, your emotions, and monitoring your emotions, plus seeing and understanding others' emotion and utilizing that intelligence for the growth of both. And here we talk about honesty, politeness, good conduct, self-evaluation, all emotions which you can utilize to enhance your life as well as the others' life. And then in integral intelligence, we speak about entrepreneurial competence, where we are talking about commitment, how sincere you are towards your goal and how sincerely you put efforts to achieve that, your persistent efforts, your patience, your hard work, your resilience, your goal-directed behavior, all will come in entrepreneurial competence. So when we talk about the basic difference between technological intelligence and integral intelligence is, in technological intelligence, the more focus is on the cognitive competencies, the analytical skills, the achievement orientation. Whereas in integral intelligence, or the understanding intelligence in Indian context, this is much wider and much holistic perspective. It gives much holistic perspective because it is including your cognitive competency, your social competency, your emotional competency, and your entrepreneurial competency. And then when we talk about emotional intelligence, so this word is basically introduced by Selvoy and Mayer, and according to them, emotional intelligence is your ability to monitor your own and others' emotion, to make a difference or discriminate among them, what are the different emotions and how it is affecting, and to use that information to guide one's behavior and thinking and action. So basically, understanding your emotion, monitoring your emotion, understanding others' emotion, under others, able to control others' emotion, and then utilizing that to achieve or to change your thinking and action and achieving the goal. Or in another word, we can say emotional intelligence also involves your ability to perceive and manage your feelings, your emotions, to motivate oneself and restrain one's impulses. But there are many students, there are many people who are very impulsive, who does not think twice before taking any decision. So and they end up doing many times wrong things. Why? Because you did not use logical thinking, and their emotions influence their logical thinking, and that's what we mean by impulsive thinking. And to handle interpersonal relationship effectively is called you are emotionally intelligent. And a good IQ and scholastic record is not enough to be successful in life. There are many people, they keep on focusing on IQ, intelligence, your score, your marks, but it is not only criteria to be successful. And if you want to be successful, you have to acquire the emotional intelligence, the social intelligence, the social competency, the emotional competency, where you can manage your emotion. Because with the nature, when the nature gives lots of or intelligence or abundance potential to a human being, he has also given a guard or also given an obstacle in terms of emotion. So until unless you learn to manage your emotion, it becomes very difficult to utilize your full potential and your cognitive competency. And then comes your creativity. So as we have already started creativity in chapter number, I think 8 of 11th class, where we have spoken how we can develop creativity, what are the methods, what are different stages. So when we talk about creativity, it is your ability to produce different ideas, the objects or problem solutions that are new, appropriate, maybe very useful to the society or to any particular goal or any particular task. And certain level of intelligence is necessary to be creative. But this is not necessary that you have a high level of intelligence in order to be creative. However, high level of intelligence does not ensure that a person would be certainly be creative. So if we say in its simple terms, we can say that in order to be creative, you need at least average level of intelligence. But high level of intelligence does not give a guarantee to the creativity. There is no disagreement that creativity is determined by both heredity and environment. There are people whose parents are very creative, so that comes in their heredity. Plus there are children whose parents were not very creative, or maybe they did not get a chance to show that creativity, but in their environment they got lots of exposure and the facilities and the like services where the child utilizes his creativity skills. So in creativity also, as in other psychological attributes, both play an important role, that is your heredity and environment. Limits of creative potential are set by heredity, and environmental factors stimulate the development of creativity. So suppose even human beings, we have the certain limits already set by just being human. So just if because you are just a human, and that is why those things comes easily to you, because those are the things in your genes. The same way there are certain limitations of human being, you know, and beyond that, no matter how much stimulation you give, you do not acquire to the higher level. How much of the creative potential can be realized, when and in what specific form and direction, is largely determined by environmental factors such as your motivation, your commitment, your effort, how much effort you are doing, your family support, your peer influence, your teacher's influence, the kind of training opportunities you are getting. So all these will affect how much creative potential you are using or developing. Although no amount of training can transform an average person to a level of Tagore or Shakespeare, etc. And that's here we are explaining that your hereditary sets a limit. But it is also true that every individual can raise her or his level of creative potential beyond its present level, where even Howard Gardner says that we all are intelligent, but some of the areas we are extremely high, some of the areas we can be average, we cannot be bad. So we can improve definitely to a certain extent, but we may not go to beyond a level in all the sphere or all the different dimensions. So when we talk about creativity test, creativity, how do we test creativity? How do we find out that people are creative or not? So creativity test came into existence to assess variations in terms of potential for creativity in contrast to the intelligence. So we developed intelligence tests, then we developed creativity tests as well. So there are creativity tests which are open-ended questions which are used in testing the creativity, and there are no specified answer to the questions or problems in creativity tests, as we have already discussed that we have closed-ended question where the scope is for creativity is not there. If I ask you what did you eat in the breakfast, you know, you'll just simply say what did you eat, so it's closed-ended question. Or if I say who is the prime minister, you know, so you will just say the name of a prime minister, closed-ended question. But how can it be open-ended question? Who all can be prime minister? What all qualities a person should have? So there will be different kind of answers you will get. So by this means, open-ended, you are leaving the scope for giving more and more ideas, more and more solution to one specific question. And there are no specified answer to the questions or problems in creativity test. Therefore, There is a freedom to use one's imagination and express it in original ways, and scoring is based upon the number and originality of a person's answers. Some of the famous psychologists who have developed creativity tests are Guilford. We have Torrance, which is again a very famous test of creativity. We have Khatana, we have Valich, we have Kogan, we have Parmish, Bakir, Mahdi, and Passy test of creativity. Nowadays, we use quite commonly used is the Passy test of creativity. And each test has a standardized procedure. So when we have already spoken about what is standardization in our chapter number 2 of 11th class. A complete set of manual and interpretation guide with where when we say manual, where everything is mentioned, what is creativity, how the test has been developed, what are the what are the administration procedure, what are the timings, how do you score, what are the norms, different norms. So all things are mentioned in the manual and interpretation guide, and that we mean by standardized procedure. And reliability, validity, everything is given in that manual. So these can be used only after extensive training in administration and interpretation of test scores. Because whoever is testing your intelligence or your creativity or any psychological attribute, that decides who is doing. Because there are many factors which will affect the score of these particular tests. There are usually in your books it is not mentioned, but when we will do practicals, these things will be taken care of. Your score can be influenced by 3-4 things. Number one is tester. Who is testing you? What is his qualification? How much trained he is? You know, what kind of rapport he's sharing with the person? Then it can be also affected by the testee, like who is giving the test? What is his motivation? How much he has understood the instruction or not, whether he is having physical fitness, like suppose if the child is coming after the school, in the evening I'll do the test, definitely there will be difference in the performance of the child. Why? Because the child is completely tired. So whether I'm doing it in the morning or in the evening, what is the time or what is the fitness level of the testee? So all these will influence the performance. Also, it can be influenced by the test itself. So tester, testee, and the test which we are giving. So if the person or the psychologist have not chosen the test, or test may have some inherited limitations, you know, test may be in different language, test may be not having high reliability or validity. So we have to always check before giving the test what is the reliability and validity of that particular test. And that will be available in your manual. Then the fourth one is your environment. So these four factors can influence the performance of the test, performance of the testee on the performance of the test. You know, what is his score can be influenced by these. The fourth one is the environment. If the environment is too hot, if it is too noisy, you know, if it is too dark, the child is not able to see, or if the child is not comfortable where he or she is sitting. So these are the environmental factors which can affect the performance of the test. So we need to be very, very careful or when we use the score of a psychological test. It's a one part of assessment. It does not give you the